We are back with the zombie infection day three. Can you believe that we've done three of these already?
Well, we've done two of these. This is the third one.
Oh, that's a good point.
Yeah. But yes, I can't believe we've done two of these already. I'm already on to the third one.
And you're already fidgeting everything. Stop fidgeting. And look at the camera. Stop looking over there like you did last week.
I always fidget. Yeah.
Look into the eyes of your audience. Good. Well, hopefully checked in last week. I look like shit. I'm just looking at myself in this,
I think the light's quite bright.
We have got a different light on. We've got all of our, we've literally got about eight, if we could show you this out, we've got about eight different lights.
Yeah.
All of our just to light lights. Us up. Yeah. And I noticed that I'm super heavily branded and you just look amazing.
I did wear a hoodie last week, didn't I? But too warm.
Too warm. It is too warm.
So if you caught us last week, we spoke about many things, didn't we?
We did, yeah.
What did we speak about last week? We spoke about...
Me calling your dad out.
Yeah, we spoke about the new 28 months later.
Yeah, potentially.
Potentially that.
So let's start off this week. We've got a new event in Liverpool, which is at the National Waterways and Canals Museum in... it's just North Cheshire. Ellesmere Port, it's called. Okay. If you haven't been, go. It's great. It's a lovely little museum about boats and stuff.
Is it big? I've not actually been there yet.
It's not huge, but it's big enough for us to get a two-hour experience in. One of the things that we always struggle when we go and see new venues is it big enough to fulfil someone's expectations for 2 hours?
Yeah, 2 hours can be a long time.
So what is it that we look for in a venue, Lucy, about... make sure that it is.
We like somewhere that has character. We do like somewhere that has character, but that's not necessarily. It's not necessarily. You know, we don't have to have somewhere that's full of character to have a 2 hour event. Somewhere that has lots of rooms to explore is a must. In the past, we've had experiences where we've had.
Why are you looking over there?
I don't
know. I'm here. We know that on the video format, because I'm one side and you're the other side, okay. You can just talk to me. Like, talk to me.
In the past, right. We've had locations such as our old shopping centre in Milton Keynes was massive. It was an old abandoned Waitrose.
We struggled with that one.
But we struggled with it because it was so open. There wasn't a lot of rooms to explore, so we had to break up the space.
And how did we do it? We did that with... I had about 40 pallets.
Oh my goodness.
And about 50 Harris fencing panels. And we created these. We had a pallet in the middle. And then we had two Harris fencing panels that sat on the side. And they made sort of like a 2.5 meter wide by 2 meter high by 1 meter thick barricades. And we had sort of loads of those that break up. It was an old Waitrose, but it didn't have any of the aisles in it.
Yeah,
so it was just the shop floor. So it was just a complete box. And that was hard.
Yeah, it was hard. So we do look for somewhere that has a lot of rooms to explore. Otherwise, it can be a bit much. Some of our other venues over the past, we've had outdoor locations. So we had somewhere called Woolerton Hall, which had loads of space inside. But also had loads of space outside. So I'm hoping that this boathouse is going to be a bit similar in terms of space inside and outside too.
I can see your hands on my thing. one of the best things about some of our new venues, like the Hangar, is that it is a box, but it's got loads of planes in it.
Why'd you say it like that?
Because it's got things to break up the space.
Yeah, it does.
So instead of a shitty little like box to hide behind, you've got a jet.
Yeah.
Jetfire, I don't know the official names. Spitfire?
Spitfire.
Yeah, it's old. I don't think they're called Spitfires now.
No, but they're the old ones, isn't they?
They're called like K4
F-17s.
F-25s. Yeah, something like that, yeah. I'm not really clued up on my planes.
Watch Top Gun.
I did, but I'm still not clued up. So that venue's really cool because it has loads of things to hide behind. And because they've like their weird shapes... You can see through, like, so it'd be really good for our infected to, like, see people come in.
So what about this? So what kind of, is there any specific things at this boathouse, any kind of, not that we want to give too much away, but in the area?
It's got an industrial feel.
Right.
It's not, nothing's square. So it's all kind of like this pathways. They're different outbuildings. So there's lots of different types of areas. And then you've got the actual canal boats themselves. So like we could put infected on the boats because you can climb over the steps, go down into some of the boats and like, you know, that's explore very cool. those. Yeah.
Without falling in the water.
Yeah.
Is that what you were going
to
say?
That's what I was going to go on to, yeah. So the one thing about this venue is the water.
Mm.
And when you're running around and you're not watching where you're going and there's nothing in between you and the water.
We're going to have to just light it, aren't we?
We are. We've got cones and things to mark out the areas where you're not allowed, like boundaries. Yeah, we do, yeah. What are you going to do, we? Why would I say that we've got it and we don't have it?
I don't know.
I've bought loads of cones. Although...
I've not seen these cones you guys before. Must
have, yeah, right. Wait there.
Is he going to go and get a cone?
You talk.
Okay. I don't know what he's doing. He's probably gone to get cones to prove me wrong or something. But well, yeah, we're very excited about this Liverpool thing. Liverpool tends to be one of our most popular locations. So we used to have, back in the day, we had an asylum in Liverpool. And then after that, we had a tower in Liverpool. And they always seem to sell out. He's back.
So we've all been there. We've all looked on Amazon and gone, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, that looks really good. Yeah, that'll be perfect for me. Oh, I know those dimensions. Yeah, 200 mil. Yeah, that'll be all right.
For a cone.
Yeah. So like with these will definitely be able to show people in the dark whilst they're running away from zombies.
First time I've seen this. That is amazing. Yeah,
this will definitely
let me hold it up to my camera.
This will definitely stop people from. That will definitely stop people from doing it.
I've had a shot bigger than this.
I'll get like 50 of those. Yeah, that will help stop. I mean, all of them combined might just be seen.
Love that. So we haven't got cones.
Well, I'm going to attach tape from one to the other, so hopefully it can create a bit of a barricade.
Or a trip hazard.
No. Nah.
Okay. I trust the process. He never gets it wrong.
Thanks.
So, yeah, Liverpool this weekend. That's amazing. I can't believe that. That's so funny. Stupid. I'm so glad you saved that for right now.
Yeah, I hate that on Amazon.
But, yeah, so they Liverpool...
They advertise them as football cones. So, like, you know, when like you're trying to go in...
Trying. No.
It's about... How is that going to stop a football? Look at the size of it compared to my hand. Look at the scale. The scale is ridiculous. So, they're the cones. So, that's a good waste of money.
Liverpool's popular, I was talking about.
Liverpool has always been popular. I don't know why. Our northern venues tend to be more popular than our southern venues. And I don't know. I can't put my finger on it.
Is it that Liverpool is because it's a big city? So is it more of like a stag do type?
Yeah.
But we get that everywhere. But I
know because I think
Sheffield as well, stag.
Yeah, so Sheffield, Nottingham, Birmingham—they're all your sort of your stag capitals, aren't they? So yeah, it's
that's why.
Yeah, that's why they're popular, I think. And we don't really have like Shepton Mallet, Somerset, Yeovil, they're not big stag. You know,
no,
Portsmouth maybe.
We're near
Southampton,
Bristol, but
maybe.
We're not. If we have one in Bristol, like big, you know, centre of Bristol, then maybe.
Yeah.
So what have you been doing to prepare for this weekend?
So I've been writing the script. Now, we wanted to talk about this on how our events... We always talk about our events like they're immersive theatre.
Mm-hmm.
We never refer to it as a game.
Mm-mm.
We never refer to it as like anything gimmicky.
Yeah.
It's always grounded within immersive theatre and reality.
Yeah.
We always want our guests to feel like it's real.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because it's, and I think sometimes that's to our detriment because... Some people just want to have a bit of a laugh.
Yeah, I mean, one of the main questions I get from customers, you know, during bookings is, oh, what if they get me? Am I out?
Yeah.
As if it's like a game.
Yeah.
And it's like, you don't really know what this is. And then I have to kind of like tell them, no, like it's a story-driven immersive experience. It's very theatrical. You know, you meet characters, you know, it's very heavy. Like you will have points where you're on your own, but it feels very real. It's not a game.
Yeah. And in the scripts that we write, they're always rounded so they don't have a lot of holes. We've all been watching things like, more recently, we wanted to talk about The Walking Dead because we're trying to finish the seasons. And there's some bits are good. Like they're definitely better than the other, like last couple of seasons, but there's still some bits you're just like, oh, why
we're in season 11, aren't we? We'll get onto that, shall we?
What was it recently about, like, so they go and search this house and they're all hiding under the floorboards, and there's more of them than there are of these other sort of this other gang or whatever, these other group of survivors. Yeah. You know, and they stood there with a shotgun in his hand. Well, he's got a clean shot, you know, just what's... I don't understand why they just wouldn't. Sometimes their logic doesn't add up.
Yeah.
In a survivor, in an apocalypse, you're just like, well, why wouldn't you just do that? Like, especially when they're fighting the infected. I said this to you when we were watching it last night, that one of the infected is really strong. And they sort of wrestle them to the ground. And this guy's got a knife and he's sort of wrestling them. And there's just not a lot of, like, why wouldn't you just do that and do that? And that makes it easier for you to deal with that type of scenario.
Whereas you can imagine us saying that to a TV screen, whereas when people say that to us in the events, like, you know, we have to, what you were going about saying about holes, like, we really have to avoid having holes because people can ask us those questions and we have to be able to adapt to them.
You do. And so, yeah, someone, so like if, because a lot of what we do is improvised, because it, you never know what, like we said last week on last week's podcast about categorising different types of characters and making sure that they have the type of event that we want them to have.
Mm.
We have to improvise to a certain extent. So if somebody says to me, well, surely it makes more sense to like sneak round the back and like keep the noise down. And it does. That's what we'll do.
If it doesn't though, then you can say in character no because X, Y, and Z. But... Yes. Obviously.
But I'm not going to try to make up some bullshit excuse try to keep us on track.
Unless it's
actually in reality that makes more sense than what they're suggesting.
But the questions are never like that, are they? They're more like they try to pick holes in maybe the story or kind of the terminology of things. I don't know. It's never usually that kind of thing. It's more like, I don't know. I don't know what to use as an example, but...
To be fair, we don't have a lot of it because I think... Over the years, we've honed it so that we answer those questions before they even come up.
And it feels very real.
I just think we tie everything together. So this week I've been writing the script for The Boathouse, and the creative process for writing a script is hard.
Mm.
And when you're running a business, especially now, because the landscape for running any business is incredibly difficult, especially with a business that is a luxury product.
Mm.
I mean, when you're trying to save money, right? What's the first thing to go? The extra bar of chocolate or the dinner out.
Oh, right. Do you see what I mean?
Yeah. So in general, so if people are trying to save money, the first thing that goes are those luxury products.
Yeah.
Those things that aren't required in order to survive. Yeah. So at the moment, when the cost of living is going up, the media's on the back of all of this thing. I mean, it's a global depression we're in right now.
Yeah. You know,
forget the fact that it's a recession. It's a depression.
Mm.
Everyone is like, right, this sucks, right?
Yeah.
When that happens, we're the first thing to go.
Yeah.
And so the business is really struggling at the moment. So when you're trying to run a business, but you're trying to be creative.
Yeah.
It's an incredibly difficult space to be.
Yeah.
And people don't understand. I'm trying to write a screenplay, a theatre play.
Yeah.
Right? Whilst I'm worrying about whether not only I can pay my own bills.
Yeah.
But whether the business will see next month.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, so how do you find that creative division, that creative space? Do I go out to a cabin in the woods and just sit there for a week? No, I can't do that. I've got to run a business.
I think a lot of that comes from the way that we were talking about the specific venues and kind of the character behind the venue itself. And now, you know, when we're lucky enough that actually the script you have written for Liverpool sounds really, really cool because of the venue opens up opportunities for you to be like, oh, we can do this here, we could do this here. Whereas if it's more of a blank canvas, it is harder.
And bear in mind, I've only been to the venue once.
Yeah, I mean, it's
so it's not like it's a stage
and
you've got exit left, exit right, backstage.
Yeah.
Here's the set. I've got like 20 exits.
Yes.
20 backstages. Like I've got to try and, from memory, I've got to try and navigate that entire site.
It will all change. I mean, when we go there on the weekend...
I think it will all change, but
in terms of which way we go in and that kind of thing. And also...
I should have taken some video when I was there the first time.
Yeah. We'll get it by the end of the first one. I think it's just, you know, you try and navigate your way around a building you don't know as well, like in the event and that kind of thing. But that's not necessarily a bad thing, because as long as you get to where you need to be, it doesn't matter necessarily which way you go.
Yeah. So it should be good fun. Should be good.
It should be good.
Interesting venue. We're doing it once this year, and then we've got dates throughout 2023. They're live. All the dates for next year are live on our website. So if you fancy coming along to the Liverpool Boathouse, it's chapter 4 in our Zombieverse. We call it our Zombieverse because we've got 7 chapters, and each chapter carries on a 30-year storyline. across the different venues, which is really cool. I was saying to you last week about how we've got a web series there, and we've got like we've got all of these things that we want. We can film it. We've got the venues. We've got the story. We've got the characters. Like, everything's there to make a really cool web series. Yeah. All we don't have is the time and the money.
Yeah. If we had money, if we had money, we'd make the time, because we'd use the money to get other people to run the events, and we could, you know, but it's just, But yeah, no, it should be good. The next one, I think, is February the 18th.
Because my background is in video. Excuse me. contagious.
I think I'm a little bit coffee, actually. I feel a bit coffee.
Virus contagious. My background is in video, so... I wanted to be a video editor when I was much, much younger. And then within film and TV, I think. And then this sort of allowed me to dip into that as well as sort of make a career from it. So I miss actually having a really decent camera and spending and writing a project, you know, rather than having to go and write an event. I would love to just get behind the camera and have a cameraman and a sound guy and just shoot our own, you know, shoot our own 20 minute. You know, we could do 6 episodes, 20 minutes long, you know, and just to do, but it's just about like money, time, you know, once the business is hopefully in a bit more of a stable position, then those types of extra things will come along, will come naturally.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. So that's cool. So what have you been up to? This is like a great preparation.
So this is what happens on when we have a new event. So Greg writes a whole thing, and then I have 2 days to learn a whole thing. Yeah. So I usually, Greg and I both, but you know, he obviously wants to step back more and be more in the director's chair, as we say. So I learn all the lines, and I usually front and center doing the events and looking after 25 people and brand new venue and not getting them to fall into water and driving the story and all that kind of stuff. So I haven't yet, but I will be trying to learn all my lines for this weekend.
I think things like this as well. Look, I'm just going to... Let's see if we can just move this here. Look.
Don't explain what it is.
You know, I spent sort of yesterday afternoon sort of like designing up these pretend patient forms.
That takes time.
And it's going to be a really cool feature of our event. To try and integrate our audiences into the actual script in the experience itself. But if I didn't have a background in graphic design, I'd have to pay someone £300 to design this over a day and then get it printed out.
See, I don't know how to do any of that.
But how am I meant to go from designing that to then like writing a script?
A story.
It's madness. Yeah, it's really, really tricky to do.
Yeah, so back to, kind of what I was saying
about scripts.
Oh yeah, about scripts. So yeah, I've got to try and learn. I've got to be able to learn a lot of script in a very short amount of time to deliver in front of loads of people without looking like I'm fluffing or getting it wrong, whilst also being able to improvise to the point where I can answer any questions at all around that story. So I could say an opening brief and then guests might be like, question it or something, and I have to be able to say the right thing after that. So it's very difficult. And I think we were talking about last week a little bit about recruitment and recruiting actors and that kind of thing. And I think there's one thing to be able to learn lines, but there's also...
I'm like trying to get her to look at me.
He's trying to get me
screen.
To stop fidgeting.
Yeah, stop fidgeting.
Doing this in my hands. Yeah. Look at the camera. And
do you know why?
Because
every time your hand pops into there and sees me. So when we cut it up, it's just your hand like trying to slap me in the face. So it's difficult. Yeah, you got to learn scripts.
I find that
it's not
just learning scripts, is it?
We don't tend to have the same... traditionally, we don't tend to have the same people in the same roles for a long period of time.
Yeah.
So you're going to have to learn a script, and chances are like you might have to then deliver it again in 6 months because someone's left that role.
Yeah.
And we have to fill in.
And I had a script to learn a couple of weeks for a new event. And then I've got, you know, this one this week, and I've got to learn the one for next week, which is part of the job. But I think that, where was I going with it?
It's part of the job, learning the script.
Yeah, I can't remember. It was more about recruitment, about why we struggle to find those lead roles is what I was coming back to.
I think it's people are enthusiastic about taking on the lead roles because you run around with, you know, guns and being a hero every week. It's great fun. but trying to retain people because it's not just performing in a play.
Yeah.
It's hard. You're covering enormous distances. I mean, I remember at the courthouse, we used to do 14 miles over a weekend.
Mm.
So four events, and bear in mind that the courthouse was only maybe 80,000 square feet. Not even that.
80,000?
30,000 square feet, maybe? I don't know. It was four, it wasn't big compared to the forest.
Mm.
But you'd do four events on the Saturday, four events on the Sunday, and you'd do about 14, 15 miles, which is just over half a marathon.
Yeah, I burn about 4,000 calories each day.
Yeah, at least 400, I do that four and a half, five. Yeah. So not only are you trying to perform, but you've got to be massively physically fit. So funny story at the weekend. So I told you this in the week about... So at the end of the forest event, we do this really big long run, top speed, all the way from the village, all the way back into the compound where we do the last stand. And I had these brilliant lads with me right at the front. And I'm like, right, you're going to need to keep up with me because I'm going to go right. And as we're leaving the village, he's like, all right, lads, we ready? We're going to keep up with him. We've got his back, right? And I said to you, it felt like I had a real squad. Because most of the time, like, people are like...
yeah, it's like, hurry up, keep up.
I can't make it. So I have to slow my pace down. But it was a nice change for these lads. They were really keeping up with me. So I thought, oh, let's see how fast they can go here. Bearing in mind that it's pitch black. They've got no torchlight. Like, the terrain is, you know, forest terrain. Right. It's crazy. Yeah. And I know the terrain pretty well. So I thought, I'll see how much they've got here. So I really started to forest gump it. And I was like...
forest gump it?
Yeah, I was like...
no pun intended, in the forest.
Yeah, well, nice. I was going at full pelt and they were keeping up with me. And it was like, we were really like
a pack of wolves.
Yeah, it was like shooting on either side.
But that's what's so good about doing these lead
roles. Yeah, it was fantastic. Yeah, it was great fun. But it's not always that. But they, you know, most people are blown out their arse by the time that they're 5 seconds into the event. And they're like, fucking hell, like this is tough. But these guys kept up with me. It was really cool. It was good fun.
Yeah,
good
fun, I think there's an occasional time where you get a really good event where you get people that are just so into it and they do your job for you and they're like, you know, you don't have to shower them. You know, imagine, you know, blowing out your ass, it's extremely physically and demanding, having all the lines, but also like you're shouting and you don't always shout, but bloody hell.
Yeah, you're
like
shouting
all the time.
You're carrying like, all the gear.
You're carrying everything. You've got like you've got a spare in your pockets, gun. You've got a spare gun. You're dealing with like breakages.
I had about, because I wear these combat trousers because they've got like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. They got 6 pockets, right? I shit you not, I had about a kilo in each pocket. Right?
Just running with your tack vest on. Yeah.
Like running, yeah. Not mention anything in my tack vest at the top, like radios, guns, belt, everything. Yeah. I'm running. I've got like, I'd lucky I had braces. I've got braces. But otherwise my trousers would have been around my ankles. I'd be dragging them along. Because they were so heavy with like spare lasers, spare torches, smoke grenades, Mark Fives, glow sticks, all of that bloody
stuff.
But
this is why we have to find people when we recruit that it's very difficult to find people that can do all those things. But the main reason why people stick with us is because you have to be able to love it to do it because it's hard.
Yeah, you
gotta love it. Not getting on a stage and performing, which is why we speak to actors and like it is. Very difficult.
You know what? I think we still do it because it's in our blood now.
Yeah.
Like, it's part of who we are.
Yeah.
I think the novelty wore off a long time ago.
It did.
I don't do it because I can't wait to do it. I do it because it's just part of me now and I just feel like that is my lifestyle. Yeah. Like, I feel like I'm in my own survival and I'm really doing it to survive, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I'm pushing it to really survive. So... I think it's my legacy as well. Like, I mean, there aren't many people that have lived out an apocalypse as much as we have or had to rescue someone from certain death or pick someone up or encourage someone to make it to the end or like, you know, give advice or like, I mean, it's mad what we do.
Yeah, we talk about kind of the overall, it's very well us being like, we do this, this and this, but... There's only so much of that we can do without the support of the rest of the cast. So we talk about events where, you know, if things quite aren't all in sync with each other and things don't hold up, then it's very difficult because we feel like we have to carry a lot of kind of there's a more pressure on our shoulders.
You need to be doing it for 6 months,
yeah,
twice a month, to be able to really get to a standard where you're comfortable.
Yeah.
It's hard. It's hard. So this is like, I guess if there's anybody out listening to this podcast, or if you know anybody that fancies taking part, then definitely come along, because it, we obviously been doing it for a long time, but it is a fun job.
Yeah,
we do have like an amazing job to go out and just have fun with the general public every weekend, shooting zombies. Like, there's far worse jobs out there. So if you know somebody or fancy just coming along, there's no experience necessary. We don't ask for like special effects makeup qualifications, or
acting,
you know, you need to know how to be a zombie. Like, we don't need to see pictures. All we need is an ethos to work hard and love what we do. Just yeah. really appreciate the fact that you get to run around and do this. That's really what we're looking for. And I spoke to you just before we came on air on this podcast, about opening it up to the stunt register, because you're a training stunt professional, right?
Yeah, so I'm not currently training for the stunt register, but a lot of my friends are training for the stunt register.
But you have been in the previous part.
Yeah,
you've been doing some types of qualifications.
Yeah, so yes, but I know one of the things for the stunt register is that you have to have a certain amount of live days of performance, and you also have to have amount of days in front of the camera.
Yeah.
So a lot of my guys, you know, do extra work and kind of do action work on camera, but they also need live performance days as well. I'm not sure how many. That's a question for one of my friends, but But we've had a few people in the past that have come in and just kind of zombied for a certain amount of time. And they've obviously got enough, I don't know how many days they need, or they might, even if it helps them, and yeah. they do other things like
we
laugh.
We ask them
or,
to do, yeah, you know, we ask them to do a minimum of 3 shifts. So they do a trial shift, which is unpaid, because we need to know whether it's right for them.
Yeah.
That's not whether they're right for us. We're happy to take you on board for the full 4 shifts, but you need to know whether it's right for you, because if it's not right for you, then you're not going to want to do the rest of it, right?
Yeah.
So fair's fair. So we were really looking for people that need to get some type of reference or qualification or live performance days as part of the training for being on the stunt register for film and TV.
Yeah.
But they must work the 4 shifts.
Yeah, that's
yeah?
fair.
So if they want a reference, then they come to us. It's like a contract. You know, you do 4 events, and at the end of those 4 events, you can stay on. We'd love you to stay on. But if you want to leave, that's absolutely fine. And we'll give you a reference to say that you've done X amount of hours doing physical theatre, you know, for the general public.
Yeah.
Yeah. So if there's anybody out there that wants to do that, then definitely get in touch with Lucy. That's where you... Email.
Oh, that's me. Email Lucy at zombieinfection.co.uk, and I will tell you all about it. And then obviously, like Greg said, we obviously would love you to stay if it's for you.
Yeah, we still have lots of people that have been with us for a number of years.
That is training for the register.
Yeah.
So,
it's good practice.
Yeah.
Yeah. Remember, like, if you want to progress as well with this, so after those 4 or 5, there's opportunities for you to do like things like gun and weapons training for film and TV. We actually get film and TV companies come and hire our actors.
Yeah, we've had
for
that
film
recently,
and TV projects, online and offline content type stuff.
Credits as well.
Credits, all that kind of stuff. So yeah, so if you know or in the stunt profession, or you fancy coming along and learning these types of skills, then definitely hit up our recruitment page.
Oh, I love this last week, right?
Zombieinfection.co.uk.
Cool.
And there's a Discover ZI on there where you can find out more about what the job actually entails. But I think this is different to the way that we've done it in the past. Normally, we would ask you to just commit, and we're only looking for people to commit. But in a world where we're really struggling to find solid members of the team and fulfill our duties and our responsibilities to these events, we're really looking for people to come on board and just give it 100%. And even if you want to give it 100% for a few shifts, then that's absolutely fine. You can come and have a good time.
Yeah. Cool.
Cool. I think that's pretty good.
Yeah.
Next week, we'll tell you how the boathouse went.
Oh,
tickets are sold out, aren't they?
Goodness. It's already been half an hour.
Oh, my goodness.
I think we've got... I can't believe it's been 30 minutes.
Yeah.
I think we've still got some available tickets for the last session, for the 10:30 session, off the top of my head, for next week. This weekend, sorry.
And keep an eye out for our discounted experience for 2, because we all know it's that time of year, and it's a great time to pick up a voucher to do one of our 2-hour experiences. Like I said, we've got amazing venues next week. We said before we came on about can't wait to do the Hangar
yeah.
in Yeovil. It's an RAF base. Like I said, it's got an indoor Concorde. I mean, it's got helicopters inside. It's mad. It's really cool. It's a different type of venue that we've used before, so it should be really, really good. But loads more. Fort in Portsmouth. Forest is still there in Nottingham. We've got our jail in Nottingham now as well. And our boathouse in Liverpool.
Just quickly, I'm going to just quickly say that we've got our last Wasteland experience next week as well in Bristol. We've still got some tickets left for that. That's our 75-minute experience.
It's a nice little taster, isn't it?
It's a nice little taster. So if you're not doing anything next Friday and you're around the southern location.
And our Zombie Academy on December the 3rd. There's still tickets left for that. So that's a three-hour experience where we'll teach you to survive. We'll teach you how to hunt, because we're going to teach you how to use like our blank firing weapons and different types of guns and melee weapons. We get to smash melons with a baseball bat.
I need to get those.
And we turn you into one of the infected. So we teach you how to become your enemy. So we break it down, an hour in each. So an hour on survival techniques. You get to make your own armor and search for supplies. Second hour is you learn how to use guns and melee weapons. Like I've got Lucille, we get to smash. Maybe we should do pumpkin season's over. I'm just wondering if it would make less mess.
Oh my goodness, these watermelons. We'll get on to that after.
And then you become an infected. So we'll teach you, we'll put some special effects makeup on you, take a photo shoot. It's all good fun. So yeah, check out our website for that. There's tickets still available on December the 3rd in Shepton Mallet. Thanks very much for listening.
Thanks.
I've been Greg.
I've been Lucy. I've been. Does that even make sense?
I'm still Greg.
Okay.
And you're still Lucy.
Yeah. Cool.
Catch you later.
Bye. Bye.
That one. You're not going to talk this week.
I did.
Yeah, I know. We keep like.